Isle brethren.
Isle brethren, sit down, mate. Man, it's good to be with you folks today. Great to be back in this area. I'm going to say a little bit more about that later. I want you to do my jump into our Bible class that morning. Because there's some things I really want to share and talk with you about that I think are really important. Let me say real quickly, though, it really is a great pleasure on me to be here today. This is home for me. Been away for a long time. And it's good to be back and balance my family. So looking forward to the next few years or so here. We'll open your Bible to John chapter 1. John chapter 1. John is one of the writers who very often in writing is not just in the gospel of John, but also in the first letter he writes, 1 John. John tells why he writes this book. And in chapter 20, verse 31, he says simply this: "But these things are written so that you might believe that Jesus is the Christ, and that by believing you may have life in his name." John's purpose for writing this book is for generating faith on the part of the hearers or the readers. And so for that reason, I especially like the Gospel of John. Because of the way he approaches a number of things in this book. As you know, there are four Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. As Mark begins his Gospel, he really does begin essentially with teaching the Gospel next. He doesn't talk about Jesus' birth, his early years. He just jumps in and starts talking about, Bobby, who is that guy next to you there? I was thinking about that. Glad to see you guys. This is going to be an initial day for me, so you often get here. Mark just jumps in and sharing the gospel message with people. Matthew and Luke both begin their gospel message talking about, describing the birth. Jesus come to earth, born of the Virgin Mary. But John begins his gospel a bit differently. And in fact, I think a very thought-provoking way. We all recognize the Bible is written by inspiration. God was the one who moved these various writers to write his word. But he gave them the freedom to describe what he says from their background, their experiences and things along those lines. As John begins his gospel, he begins this book with these words: "In the beginning." Now, if we stop there, I imagine every one of our minds would go back to Genesis chapter 1, verse 1. In the beginning, God created heaven and the earth. Folks, I really do believe that's exactly John's purpose for giving this book the way he does. In Genesis chapter 1, God is creating things. One of the things he creates is mankind. And he creates life, physical life. Jesus has come for the purpose of creating a new life. John wants us to think back to that early time, creation. Jesus has come for the purpose of creating a new spiritual life. People who can now have a relationship with God through this word, this logos he talks about, the especially these first 18 verses. Jesus, his very son. And so John chapter 1 verse 1 says, "In the beginning was the Word. The Word was with God. The Word was God." Short verse. Absolutely filled with significance and filled with truth. Jesus is God's Word. Jesus coming to earth was God's Word live. If you ever wondered, thought about how would one live if they were able to live God's Word perfectly, all you have to do is believe in Jesus. He is God's Word lived to perfection. In the beginning was the Word. The Word was with God. Huge significance in this statement. The Word was with God. The implication of significance is, among other things, this Word is eternal. Before God ever started creating, the Word already existed. This Word is eternal. And then the last little statement of verse 1, we're told that this Word was God. We all recognize that God the Father is God. But I've gone through the years of people struggle with the idea that Jesus is God. I mean, those have to come right back to this. In John chapter 1, verses 1 through 18, is essentially an introduction to the Gospel of John. He describes in these first 18 verses how the Gospel of John is going to work out. As he's beginning this, he wants to make this point that this Word, who we'll learn in this little while is Jesus, is eternal. He was and is also God. Both the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit have the qualities and characteristics of the deity and God. John realizes the significance of it. He realizes the importance of it. Now, in verses 1 through 13, There are a few things that John really wants people to think about, and he introduces in this section. First, that this logos, this Word, is eternal. Verses 1 and 2 come together. He second wants to emphasize that all things were made through that Word, through Jesus. In these first 13 verses, he also wants to emphasize that in him, in this Word, was life. Also, that this life was the light of men. And then verse 12, he emphasizes the idea that through this Word, we have the opportunity to become children of God. Now, I want to talk about these verses just a little bit. Verses 1 through 18, introduction to this gospel book. But I divide the first 18 verses into five sections. Folks, the New Testament, the Bible is written in paragraphs. Just like if we were to sit down and write a letter to a friend or a family member, we write that letter, and when we move from one subject to another, we start a letter. Paragraph. That's just the way New Testament is written. emphasized the fact that the Word is the beginning, this Word was with God, and the Word was God. It says, verse 2, He was in the beginning with God. Those two verses, I think, form a complete thought. So I tend to give the paragraphs a title that goes through the New Testament, the Bible as well, the New Testament. And just simply, I refer to these first two verses as the eternal Word. And these two verses, John introduces this eternal Word. Verses 3 through 5, his emphasis on the fact that this eternal Word is the Creator of all things. And so it says, all things were made through Him. Without Him was not anything made that was made. Again, when we read statements like this, we think back to Genesis chapter 1, at the beginning, God created heaven and earth. And so we think of, when generally speaking, I think, when we hear the word God, our first thought probably is God the Father. And so, when we think of the Creator, we think of God the Father. I do indeed believe that the Father was the Creator, but the instrument, folks, through whom He used in creating all things was Jesus. There are three sections of the New Testament you go to if you wanted to think about, study about the one who did the creating. Obviously here in John chapter 1, but a couple of other places is in the book of Colossians, Colossians chapter 1. Verses 15 and following, Colossians 1, 15 and following, Paul writes there, speaking of Jesus, He is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of all creation. When Paul speaks of Jesus as being the firstborn of all creation, this expression does not mean that Jesus was the first thing God created. The thought, the idea, the meaning of this statement is one of preeminence. It's not referring to a time when Jesus may have been created, but He is supreme, He is first, He is over all creation. It refers to a position of rank and superiority. And so verse 15 says, He is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn, the preeminent one, the supreme one over all creation. Verse 16, For by Him all things were created, in heaven and earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or dominions, rulers or authorities, all things were created through Him and by Him. He is before all things, and in Him all things hold. Yeah. This last acquisition, stop thinking about something. When we think about creating, we think of probably several things. One of the things I think about is can you imagine the power? Can you imagine the simple, raw power of one who can create? And folks, I know you understand, but let me just say quickly, the idea behind creation is the idea of bringing something into existence which did not previously exist. Now, I challenge you to do that. Oh, some of us are pretty good with our hands. We can do some things. We can make all kinds of things, build all kinds of things, do some great work. But we can't make anything that didn't previously exist. But not just that. God not only created things from things which previously exist, but He holds all those things together. Now listen. Science is a remarkable thing. We learn with the help of we are beginning to get an idea of how large our universe is. And not just that, but how it's continued to expand. And our God, someone estimated that if one could travel from one end of our universe to the other, that it would take about 100-something light years traveling distance. And our God not only created things, He holds our universe together. The reason why planets don't just fly off on their own, God will bless them. Our God's an amazing being. We stopped by quarantine, is that right? But it didn't fall. But I want to go do some things before we stop here. But if you also look at who the Creator is, if you look at Hebrews chapter 1, verses 1 and 2, won't take the time to read those. But those three sections of Scripture that talk about Jesus being created, John chapter 1, Colossians chapter 1, and Hebrews chapter 1. Now this, I want to share one section of Scripture with you. Hold in John chapter 1 and turn to Philippians chapter 2. The idea of Jesus being God is foreign to some. To me, the greatest single section of Scripture talking about Jesus being deity is Philippians chapter 2. Philippians chapter 2, begin verse 5, Paul writes and says this: "Have this mind in you, which was also in Christ Jesus your Lord, who, though he was in the form of God," before Jesus came to earth, he was in the form of God. Now when he says he's in the form of God, he's not meaning to imply that Jesus was like God. What he's saying is that Jesus was by his very essence, by his very nature, God. And so, again, this verse, "Have this mind among yourselves, yours in Christ Jesus, who though he was in the form of God," though he was God, "did not think that equality with God was something to be grasped or to be held on to." Then Paul writes and says, "But he emptied himself." A lot of Bibles word that different. The New International Version says, "He made himself nothing." Literally, that expression means he emptied himself. How did he empty himself? When did he empty himself? I believe that's described in the next statement. Made himself nothing. Emptied himself. Taking the form of a slave. Made it like a man. Most translations say, use the word servant. Came as a servant. That's not a bad translation, but it's a poor translation. It really is. Because the word there is the word which describes a bond servant, a slave. Jesus, who was, before he came to earth, by his very nature, by his very essence, God, emptied himself, taking the form of a slave, made it like a man. Folks, you and I think being a human being is pretty good. No, it's not. It's not a choice. But for Jesus to even try to describe this has been ridiculous. But for Jesus, becoming a man was a huge, huge, huge step Becoming a man, he gave up some things. We'll talk about some of those things maybe a little bit later. But in John chapter 1, verses 3 through 5, the Bible emphasizes Jesus is indeed the creator of all things. So I want to just kind of change tracks here because there's some things I want to talk about. In John chapter 1, verses 1 through 18, there are several things John lays the groundwork for the rest of the gospel. And I want to share with you over the next few minutes what a few of those things are. First, John emphasizes in this segment that God became flesh. Well, that's almost unthinkable. We read John chapter 1, verse 1. The beginning was the Word was with God, the Word was God. But we don't yet know who that Word is. If we skip down to verse 14, we learn that that Word became flesh and dwelt among us. And as we read down through verse 18, we learn that this is indeed Jesus. Everything in verses 1 through 13 lead up to what's described in verses 14 through 18. Folks, when the Word became flesh, God became man. There's so many things to be said about that. The first one that comes to my mind simply is this. This alone describes the amazing love God has for man. To what extent would you go for other people? Well, I might put out a few bucks or something, a few dollars if I can help them. Or I might spend the morning or afternoon doing it. In fact, a couple people do something. But to give up my life, to leave my eternal home, give up my life, come and live as a human being on earth, when I've had the freedom of being deity, it's an amazing thought. And of course, we all know about the amazing love of God. That God would become man. Now, I want to mention this, and really just remind you of this, I'm sure. When we talked about Philippians chapter 2, verses 5, 6, and 7 a while ago, that Jesus emptied himself, take the form of a slave, made in likeness of man. Jesus never gave up his qualities or his characteristics of being deity, of being God. He never gave that up. That's what makes Jesus unique in the world, in history. Jesus was both God, completely God, and completely man. I took the time some time ago to read through the New Testament. Not one time, but as I was reading through the New Testament, I took the time to make notations of Scripture where the Bible refers to Jesus as being God. I was surprised, even honestly. There are a number of verses which emphasize the fact that God. And then in John 1:14, this Word became flesh. And so later on, I went through the New Testament, I'm reading it again, and I made the notation of all scriptural references referred to Jesus as being human. You see, the New Testament clearly teaches that Jesus was both God and man. Nobody can make that claim. So John makes the point that Jesus became flesh. He dwelt among us. He lived among man. Second thing that John does in these first 18 verses that I think is just hugely important, significant, is the idea that emphasizes that Jesus is full of grace and truth. Both of those thoughts are worth some very serious study. Jesus was full of grace and truth. It's interesting that in the Gospel of John, John uses the word grace only four times. And all four of those times are this paragraph, John 1, verses 14 through 18. Are you aware that Jesus never taught a specific lesson that he was up in grace? When I learned that, I had to try it. But yet, Jesus is the very epitome of grace. So many things need to be understood about this idea of grace and truth. The word grace, though, always carries with the idea that it is something which is unearned, undeserved, unmerited. You can't work for it to deserve it. You can't have enough money to purchase it. It is a gift. I remember years ago when I first heard this described as a free gift. And that was different for me. And it got my attention. But I started looking at things, and you know, a gift is free. You don't buy a gift. It's given to you. It's just that it's a gift. Romans chapter 6, verse 23, all right, it's there. But the wages of sin is death. But the gift, and many translations translate that by saying, but the free gift of God, eternal life. Grace is something which cannot be deserved, cannot be earned, cannot be perfect. It is just simply that. It is a gift. But I want to share this with you, people. The word grace is one of those words which is multifaceted. It has several nuances or significant things about it. One of those things is the word charge is sometimes used to translate this word, but it's most often translated grace. The idea of grace carries with it a certain charm or a certain winsomeness. Jesus was the epitome of that. You've all read the Gospels, and you're all made aware of the fact that Jesus seemed to be always very comfortable around sinners. You know, I'll tell you something else I've noticed. Sinners seem to be comfortable around Jesus. A number of times there are different people described as being the presence of Jesus or Jesus being their presence. Some of them characters, some of them pretty wicked people, some of them are pretty despised by the people around them. But Jesus demonstrated this aspect of grace. This winsomeness, this charmness. And we need to exemplify the life of Jesus in our lives as well. John chapter 3, verse 16, go to the text of the Bible, and most of us learn to quote that from childhood. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son. Whoever believes it should not perish but have everlasting life. But I often wonder how many can quote the verse after it, verse 7. Verse 17 says, "For God did not send His Son into the world to condemn the world, but the world through Him might be saved." Jesus was all about people. He was all about saving them. He was all about relationship. A couple things real quick. John chapter 1 verse 16. John says, "We've all received grace upon grace." We've all received grace upon grace. Read a few years ago about this word grace, and I came across this illustration. I like it. I grew up here in this area, Brush Creek, Green River. Not a lot of ocean, not a lot of water. Creeks, but they show it, but not a lot of water. Well, 1985, my wife and I moved to Sarasota, Florida. Beautiful. On the Gulf of Mexico. We'd often go out on Friday afternoon, several of us would go by a Subway shop, buy a sandwich, we'd go out. We'd sit on the beach and watch the sun go down. And as we watched the sun go down, you'd hear the constant inrolling of the waves. Started looking. And in came one wave after another, after another, after another, and it's kept. And someone used this illustration as an example or definition or describe this idea of grace. We receive grace upon grace. That grace just keeps coming like one wave after another. I like that picture. I'm grateful for God's grace because I know how badly I really do need His grace. Third thing, these first 18 verses that John really does emphasize that's key to the entire book, and that is what we started out talking about. The fact that Jesus is God. Don't know how many translations you folks are using. I am teaching and preaching these days from the English Standard Version. I really do like it for several reasons. It's a fairly literal translation. It's very easily, I think, very real. The problem with literal translations is they're not easy to read. They don't flow smoothly, so they're difficult to read sometimes. But this translation I like. This introductory paragraph, verses 1 through 18, begins with emphasizing the fact that Jesus is God. And it closes with that same thought. Verse 18. The reason I made reference to other translations is because I grew up using King James Version. And many of the newer translations are very different from what the King James Version said. I'm not demeaning at all the King James Version. It's been a very good translation. It's been around for a long time. Used by a lot of people. But there are some better translations today available. The English Standard Version in John chapter 1 verse 18 reads as follows. "No one has ever seen God. The only God who is at the Father's side, He has made Him known." Some of the translation, the King James Version, the American Standard Version, doesn't really make clear what is revealed in so many of the manuscripts used to translate Scripture. And that is the fact that Jesus, verse 18, is a reference of Jesus as being God. So, John chapter 1 through 18, that little paragraph, an introductory paragraph from the rest of the Gospel of John, that paragraph begins in verse 1, verse 18, inside the beginning of Jesus. The Gospel of John does essentially the same thing. Here in this first chapter, emphasizing the same thing. 21 chapter, the Gospel of John. In John chapter 20, there's a story that is familiar to so many of us. The story of Thomas, doubting Thomas, chapter 20. You remember the story about Thomas? Jesus, that first Sunday following his crucifixion, raised from the dead. The apostles are gathered together with the exception of Thomas. And Jesus appears to them. And so sometime in the next few days, the other apostles meet John, Thomas come across him, and they talk to him. Jesus has been raised. And we all refer to Thomas as doubting Thomas, as that not doubting Thomas. That kind of puts him in a negative light. I don't know if that's heard. Thomas just wanted to be sure. He wanted to be convinced himself. Now, how different would we all say? We want to know for sure. We want to know. We appreciate what others have to say, but I want to know. I want to learn. That's right. So Thomas says, I am not going to believe he's been raised from death unless I can reach out and feel, touch those scars in his hands and his side. So the next Sunday, Jesus appears to the apostles. This time Thomas is present. I would love to have seen this incident. Because I don't know how to characterize it. You see, it could be looked at as though Jesus is calling Thomas a little bit. So he goes up to him and says, okay, Thomas, you want to touch these scars? All right. Reach out your hands. Now, the Bible doesn't say that Thomas ever did that. Personally, I doubt he did. I don't think he did. Because he now had seen Jesus with his own eyes. He didn't need to touch him anymore. He's seen him. And you remember the words Thomas used then. He said, my Lord and my God. Folks, Jesus didn't threaten him. He didn't say, oh, I'm funny from his understanding. Jesus accepted that proclamation. Thomas made. You are my God. So the Gospel of John is written for the purpose of creating, generating faith on the part of its hearers and its readers. That's one of the reasons I really love this book. John writes in some unique ways. Both in the Gospel of John and in the letters he writes, 1st, 2nd, 3rd John, John will use words which have more than one meaning. And so, we come to those words and we have to stop and think, well now, by John using these words, does he mean this or does he mean this? I want to suggest to you, John uses these words purposely because he wants people to stop and think about those words. Realize those words can have more than one meaning. Maybe he doesn't mean those words mean either this or this, but maybe he wants it understood that these words mean all of them. All those words involved. We should spend time studying the Gospel of John. I'm looking at the clock in the back. I've not heard any bell. Let's get deal. And so I'm going to stop. It's great to see you folks. And I'm looking forward to the day. Thank you very much. God bless you.